I'm just going to get right in here because I know that we are short of time. So within Born in Bradford, one of the particular interests of mine has been looking at the environmental influences on health. And I think this talk leads on really nicely from the work that Martine has been doing.
How is this? Oh, brilliant.
Okay. So I just wanted to put this slide up and Martine may recognise. Do you recognise where this is, Martine? This is, we as people, as society, we all have a very natural affinity with nature. And I think this quote by Sylvia Plath really, for me, encapsulates certainly how I feel when I get out somewhere really beautiful. Nature has been the inspiration for poets, artists, and architects for so long, and some of the best pieces of art we've got are all intrinsically linked with amazing nature that we have across the world. Oops, wrong way. Okay. However, times are changing, okay? So it's no longer the fact that many of us live in the sort of period drama romps where you've got romping through verdant meadows. Almost 50% of the world's population now live in urban areas. And this is a big issue for these people because it means how do we actually get access to nature? And how does not having access to as much nature on your doorstep as we may have been used to in the past impact on your health? And that's something that our research topic within BIM has been exploring. When I talk about green space, there are a number, I mean, you think it's quite a simple thing, but actually there's a number of different ways in which you can talk about and describe green space. Green space can range from very formal areas like parks and gardens that are managed, typically owned by local authorities, but actually green space can also refer to what you have in your neighbourhood. So it could be the grass verge that your kids play on, or it could be the alleyways that that you run up and down and that have trees, or it could be trees on the, you know, trees outside your house. So it's quite a broad definition. Is that gone really loud? It's a bit of feedback. Okay. So how do we measure green space? This is a bit pixely, but does anybody know what this is? What this is a picture of?
Bradford.
Excellent. So this is a picture of Bradford in terms of green space. So how we measure green space in terms of a lot of the research that we're doing is that we use satellite images. So we get satellite images of Bradford and we derive our index, which is called the Normalised Difference Vegetation Index. Is that right, Chris? Okay. And it's basically just an index saying how green is the environment in which you live. And on this map here, you can see the sort of areas in purple are areas which are really not green at all. And this, I don't know how to work this. Oh, brilliant, right. So that's the centre of Bradford. Media Museum's probably about there. You can see where there's not much greenery around us. As you go out to our, oh, Bingley. Oh, I'm not doing well with these slides.
Right.
This pointer, hang on, let me get back up. Wrong current slide. Okay, yeah, so, and then as you go out towards Bingley and Keighley, you can see it's a lot greener. And I just have to have a big shout out to my erstwhile colleague, Graham Smith, who's not here today, down in Staffordshire University, because calculation of these measures from satellite images, particularly within Northern England, is very problematic because of cloud cover. So Graham probably spent hours and hours going through daily pictures of Bradford over the past 5 years trying to find pictures with no clouds. And actually what you find is that there's only two images in about the past 5 years. Okay, so what we do then is that we get, also within Born in Bradford, because we've got really rich information on where people live, we can identify where people live and we can give them a score as to how green their environment is. So somebody who's living up in Bingley or Keighley here, they're in a very green environment, they have a higher score. Somebody who's in more of the inner city areas here have a lower score. And as you might expect, it's a very complex picture when you want to link green space to health, because you can imagine that if you're somebody who's living in your more urban areas, possibly more deprived areas, you've got less green space, but because you're in very deprived areas, you've got lots of other things which are impacting on your health and well-being. So it can be quite complex to try and link the effect of green space to health. So what we have done in the Born and Bradford cohort so far, and this is just the beginning of many findings that are going to come out looking at the effects of these environmental influences on health, is that we've done a lot of work looking at depression in mums when they're pregnant. So we asked mums when they were pregnant to report symptoms of severe depression. So these were items like whether people felt that their life was worth living and how they were coping. Okay, and depression in mothers is a very important issue. It's got negative impacts on the health of the mother, but also can track on to child outcomes as well. And we also looked at birth weight of children as well, because we know that if you have a child who has a lower birth weight, then that can, if they're classified as low birth weight, then that can track to poorer health and development outcomes as they grow up. And the reason I've got a web here, a spider's web, is that we know that all these other factors are predictors of both depression and low birth weight. So we need to make sure that we, when we're looking at this analysis, that we're taking into account the fact that there's individual factors which impact on depression and birth weight, such as your age, ethnicity, how many children you've already had. There's also all these socioeconomic factors like deprivation, wealth, and education. And there's also health behaviours, so your general lifestyle choices as well, like whether you drink alcohol, whether you're physically active, or whether you smoke. So what we have to do then is to disentangle the effects of all these variables before we can come out with the unique prediction that green space gives to health. So we have a couple of research papers out on this. One was led by my colleague Payam, who's based with Martine out in Creal, and the other one we are just submitting and is under review at the minute. But what we found is, we looked with our sample of Born and Bradford mums, we looked to see how green the environment was where they lived, and then we use the magic of statistics to disentangle all the other conflicting and confounding factors, and we look at our outcome. So if we take depression first, it's quite a striking finding. So taking into account all these different factors, women who lived in the greenest areas of Bradford were 18 to 23% less likely to report symptoms of severe depression. Interestingly, we only find this in the more deprived groups. Okay, so if you are in a more deprived area, there is this strong effect of green space, which is not apparent if you're in a more affluent area. And I think for those of us who work within public health, this is actually a really exciting thing for us, because we know typically that health interventions tend to benefit those who are more affluent rather than those who are in more need. So that if we can actually go in and intervene at a neighbourhood level and really improve things for people in some of the most deprived areas, then that's a really good way of trying to reduce health inequalities. We also found impacts of green space on birth weight. So we find that the greener the area that you lived in, controlling for all these factors, the healthier the weight of your child. So about a 10% increase in greenery in your environment is associated with around 16 to 22 grams heavier child. Interestingly for this finding, we find that this relationship is only for white British women and not for South Asian women. And this is something that we're not too sure why this is happening, and we're doing a lot of work within Born and Bradford now trying to explore why this might be the case, which leads me onto my next slide. So this is one of my favourite places to go. This is a picture of Harlow Carr in Harrogate, which I love to go and visit. These are my children who are playing Zombie Apocalypse Temple Run. And what I thought particularly funny about this picture is here is a lovely couple who are just setting up easels to paint a really nice relaxing watercolour of the beautiful flowers. So a nice juxtaposition there between different uses of green space. So if we think about why green space might have an impact on health, and I'll race through this because I have 1 minute. Physical activity. Okay, so it could be that if we've got more green space in our environments, we're more likely to go out and be physically active, and we know physical activity is a great behaviour for health. One of the other explanations is about stress. It's about stress reduction and stress restoration. So that if we can go somewhere beautiful, like this couple are here, and do something which takes our minds off the daily stresses and strains of life, then that can impact on our health as well. Third explanation, I don't know if you can really see, but there's just a couple out promenading there. I don't know if they were on a date or not. But we know that social support is very important for health. So it could be by being out in green spaces. We have much more time to spend with our families and our friends, and that can have the positive impact on health. And then finally, it could be something as simple as pollution. So it could be you've got less pollutants when you're in these areas. So this is what we're going to be doing in the coming years with our research programme within Bourne and Bradford. And just a final slide is about thinking about quality as well. Okay, so we've talked a lot in this talk about the quantity of green space, but actually we need to start thinking about how nice it is for people to be around. And just as Roger kicks me off, I just like to give a big shout out to the collaborators on this work, which was done as part of the phenotype project. So, thank you very much.